Okay, so welcome everybody. Thank you for the patience. Probably some participants will be checking their emails later and will join. However, we are recording this meeting. My name is Cristina Kasparian from the Bulgarian Industrial Association that has provided this opportunity for the Bulgarian companies that working in the food sector for us and Japan has a growing interest for our food sector. So it will be really very interesting for us to learn from how we can take good advantage of the agreement between EU and Japan and to understand and learn more about the Japanese food sector and how we can be successful there. We would like to thank to EU Japan Center for Industrial Cooperation that was really very responsive and collaborative to make this webinar happen for our companies. So please, Eva, go ahead. That's all from me, and to wish you a very fruitful webinar, and so let it be very, really very useful for everybody.
Dear Cristina, thanks very much for this kind introduction and for literally saving the day today. It's a pleasure to co-host this expert support webinar with the Bulgarian Industrial Association. To all participants as well, thank you very much for joining the session. And we're very sorry again for all the technical difficulties we encountered this morning. My name is Eva, and I'm a business support coordinator at the UJapan Center and the moderator of today's webinar. Before the start of our experts' presentations, I would like to take just a couple of minutes and very, very briefly present to you the support activities of the center and just to tell you how you can hopefully benefit from it. So the center is kind of a unique venture in the sense that we're partially funded by the European Commission and partially funded by the Japanese Ministry of Economy, Trade and Industry. That is to say that we're a non-profit governmental organization and all of our activities are free of charge and you shouldn't be afraid to use them. We have two offices headquartered in Tokyo and in Brussels, and together we try to promote all forms of industrial trade and investment cooperation between European and Japanese entities. For further information, I would like to mention today just the two key websites that we have in place. So on the first one, on the ujapan.eu website, you can find all the information about our activities and all events that we're normally organizing on a yearly basis, including various seminars, virtual matchmaking missions, webinars, trainings, and other similar information. On ubusinessinjapan.eu, you can find a bit more practical information on different sectors of your interest in Japan. We also have a vast library of market reports, over 100 reports covering all industrial sectors in Japan. And additionally, we organize several webinars on a weekly basis on numerous topics. And technically, it's most likely without any technical problems. In addition, if you have more specific detailed inquiries, you can also send us an email to info@ujapan.eu. And just to briefly mention that our other support activities include, just to name a few, matchmaking missions to Japan for companies working in biotech, ICT, and nanotech sectors, various training programs and seminars in Japan and Europe, cross-cultural and expert support workshops and webinars with our dear Enterprise Europe Network partners, such as one today, and we also have several help desks in place for any other related inquiries. For more information, do not hesitate to check our websites or as listed on the slides above, or contact me directly at evaujapan.eu. And now, without further ado, I would like to present our first expert today, Ms. Chiyako Nakabayashi. who will provide more insights on expert-related procedures and guidelines, and later on a Japanese business culture. Ms. Nakabayashi worked at the UN Industrial Development Organization in Vienna and the UN Food and Agriculture Organization in Rome, as well as for Japanese government agencies for Japan's ODA programs. She's a licensed lecturer on business management for manufacturing and service businesses. She's currently based in Brussels and Tokyo for consultancy and academic teaching. Ms. Nakabayashi, pleased to have you as our expert today. And sorry again for all the technical difficulties. And go ahead, if you can hear us, the floor is yours.
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes, Ms. Nakabayashi, we can hear you.
Okay, thank you very much. Welcome to the Export Support webinars. Today, I'm present in two webinars. The first one is Bulgarian food exports to Japan. And later on, I will present Japanese business culture. Now, can you tell me how to proceed to the next slide? Do I press this one? No. Can you?
Ms. Nakabayashi, you can just use your keyboard. You should
no,
be,
it doesn't move.
Or unless you're, if you're not a co-host, then you probably not. Christina, is it possible to change Ms. Nakabayashi's status very quickly if it's not too troublesome to a co-host? Or Ms. Nakabayashi, I can do it for you as long as you tell me.
Can you go to the next slide?
Sure.
Slide two?
Uh-huh.
So in the next 40 minutes, I'm presenting a practical information on the Bulgarian food export to Japan. Particularly, I'll be answering to your request, which we preliminarily received on organic food, natural food supplements, spices, functional and healthcare food, processed agro-based food, gourmet food, specific original products. And then I'm going to mention about GIs, geographical indications of products of Bulgaria, and also specialized Bulgarian food products. Today's agenda is as shown on the slide. Number one, Japan's food market, consumer behaviors in the market and the product orientation. And I'm going to mention about the processed food and the packaged food. Number two, EU and then the Bulgaria food exports to Japan. Number three, import clearance process and the procedures at the Japan customs. I'm going to talk about organic and functional foods and requirements, certain requirements for nutritious and health claims. Number four, trade shows and due diligence. On the issue of how to meet your Japanese partners. And I will conclude the webinar with question and answer sessions. Can you go to the next slide, please? So let's start with the first topic, Japan's food market. And we will identify consumer demand for Bulgarian food products. As you see on the table, Japan is 127 million consumer market. It's about 18 times larger than the Bulgaria, or almost the population of Spain and Germany combined. Bulgaria is very rich in agriculture productions. On the other hand, Japan's agriculture sector is quite small because of limited arable land and because of decreasing agriculture workforce. Japan is a net food importer. Japan's calorie-based food sufficiency rate has fallen to a record low of 37%. Bulgaria's caloric self-sufficiency rate is 171. So you could see that Bulgaria is among the top food exporters, in particular within the EU. The food and drinks are the largest expenditure for Japanese household. On average, Japanese spend a quarter of their disposable income on foods and then drinks, much more than the average Bulgarians who spend on average 23% of disposable income. Can we go to the next slide, please? So now we'd like to review Japanese market orientation. Japanese consumers' purchase decision concerns food safety and quality. And consumers are willing to pay given prices for food safety and quality. There are three ways to win Japanese consumer trust and loyalties. Number one, safety and quality are guaranteed by certifications. Number two, safety and quality are approved with the traditional production method. Number three, safety and quality are clearly disclosed on the product labels. This way, products offer the accountability, authenticity, and transparency to Japanese customers. Japanese society is, as you know, rapidly aging. Life expectancy rates increased to 84.2 years, and birth rate declined to 1.36. Currently, more than a quarter of population is over 65 years old. These demographic changes created the market segment, quite unique market segment for healthy food products in Japan. Can we go to the next slide, please? Japanese consumers are quite health conscientious. But generally speaking, Japanese consumers lack interest in organic food. And unlike the EU, Japanese consumer profile does not fit with the global general trend toward natural products and natural ingredients. Japanese consumers rather trust domestic Japanese product than imported organic alternatives. For instance, from the regulation point of view, for food safety and quality control measures, Japan's food regulation require a display of the following: one, product name, storage method, expiration date, shelf life, producer, importer, allergen, GMO, country of origin, ingredients, and additives. In particular, details information is required on number one, allergic components, two, nutritious component, three, health claim. For your information, I'm going to show you slides on these specific instructions. The first slide is about allergens. You can see that there are 7 mandatory ingredients and 20 recommended ingredients on the table shown on the screen, which are required to display to alert consumers on possible allergic responses. So for Japanese customers, allergic food is a part of healthy goods to maintain their health. Can you go to the next slide, please? So as for nutritious component, as shown on the table, there are 3 types of requirements. One, mandatory. Two, voluntary but recommended. Three, voluntary labeling requirements. So healthy foods in Japan are categorically called functional foods. And the category of organic food is not perceived as most popular choices for healthy food and drinks. So the organic or bio or natural, they categorically comes under functional food. Can we move to the next slide, please? This one is as for health claims. When you make a health claim on product packages, Japan has a quite strict rules on functional and nutritious claim on food labeling. So see the diagram shown on the screen. You could see that there are 2 types of food which are not allowed to claim health functions. On your right, in a circle, purple circle, square, it's a general food product. On your left, in a green square, you see the pharmaceutical and the quasi pharmaceutical product. They are not allowed to claim health functions. Now I'd like you to see the three squares in the middle within the dot. There are only three types of foods which are allowed to make a health claim. The first one is a food for specified health uses. It's called FOSHU, F-O-S-H-U. These are used for the sick people, for pregnant, lactating women, for infants, and for elderly people. These specified health uses, circled in red, requires a governmental registration. These are special food. Move on to the second and third one. Second one is a food with the nutrient function claims, FNFC. The third one is a food with function claims, FFC. These are for fresh and the processed food, which have a specific health benefit. They both can make a health claims without any governmental approvals. But you need to get this the registration at FNFC and FFC, which are quite affordable, and then you could apply and then you get the registrations. And it's quite fast to get the registrations. Can we move to the next slide, please? Now, we briefly review the Japanese food product orientation. And I will examine some Bulgarian food. Many Japanese now face a busy modern life and live in a small family unit, say 1 to 3 persons per household. Today, Japanese consume more processed food, but they choose a freshly prepared and well-controlled processed food under strict expiry date. And in Japan, there's an expiry time. In a city life, consumers choose convenient packaged food for breakfast and lunch and dinner. And these packaged foods are frequently sold under Japanese OEM, or you might call it just the private labels of retail stores, are their main marketing attractions to gain consumer loyalties. Now we move to the next slide. In Bulgaria, about 1/3 of the country is utilized, land is utilized for agriculture. Mixed agriculture such as wheat and corn, as well as dairy farming are popular. Many agriculture products such as tobacco, grapes, and roses are exported mainly to EU countries. So on the slide, you could see some Bulgarian packaged food products. I think Bulgaria responded quite efficiently to the Japanese consumer demand, which requires more packaged food. These are all currently sold in Japan. They are sold after making very careful marketing efforts by the Japanese importers or Japanese distributors through appropriate outlets. Many are sold as organic or vegan products. You may recognize them, but so let me just introduce from left to right, from top to bottom. The first one you might recognize, it's a cherry blossom honey. It's sold at a Japanese coffee chain shop. Next one is a caffeine-free raspberry leaf tea. Next one is a butter coconut chips. This is also produced by the Bulgarian Smart Organic Company. Next one is wafer called, Rimetska. It uses ancient wheat called ain corn. Next one is rice up, brown rice chip. This is also sold at the natural store, convenient stores. Next is a protein root bar. This is very popular in Japan. The last one is Baker's Rusk. crumble bruschetta. Can we go to next slide, please? Now I show you more Bulgarian food products being sold in Japan now. You may recognize them by their names or by packages. Most of them shown on the slide now are imported and sold without any re-engineering, so that these products are simply sold in a small outlet in a remote locations, not in the large cities. And they are often sold at a discounted shop. So it's quite the contrast to those products I showed to you on the previous slide. To make your product successful in Japan, Bulgarian exporters may consider associating with the Japanese partners, importers, distributors, retailers, and study Japanese market very carefully and re-engineer taste, sizes, packages, outlets, and so on, in order to make your product successful. Can we go to the next slide, please? Okay, I show you one of the products packages. Packages or container of food product carry required information. It's required by the Japanese law. Now you see it's just JAS on the back side of the product, Bulgarian product. Can we go to the next slide, please? So Japan Agriculture Standard, that stands for JAS. And this JAS for organic food. This JAS is a standard for the organic plants and the organic processed food of plant origin in accordance with the Codex Alimentarius Commission. Organic on your product to be sold in Japan. Your company needs to be registered at Japanese authorities and receive JAS logo. Japan recognizes Bulgarian organic products so that it's quite easy for Bulgarian products to apply for Japanese organic JAS logo. I take your attention that on top of this plant-based products, as from 16 July of this year, 2020, this JAS logo is also required for any organic livestock products and organic processed product with animal origin ingredients. I gave you a link at the bottom of the slide for the details. Can we go to the next slide, please? So now I want to move on to the next product, wines. Although most are shipped to EU countries, Bulgarian wines are becoming quite popular in Japan. As you see at this moment, it's the small amount are exported to Japan. But it's, if you are the wine exporters, wine producers, probably you could expect this the under the EPA, EU-Japan EPA, wine export could be promoted much farther. Can we go to the next slide, please? So as under the EU-Japan EPA, the EU and Japan reciprocally recognize each other's special status of agriculture and food products from the specific GI, geographical indications. There are only two wines, namely Torakista Nisuina, Donavska Lavinia. These two wines has EU GIs. They are equally protected in Japan. However, this, there are only two. So what could be alternative is that the Japan also protect agriculture products and liquor marked and sold in Japan under its own Japanese GI logos. I show it to you on the slide. Japan geographical indications. This also includes the non-Japanese products like a Bulgarian product, Bulgarian wines. I want to show you that this one case is that in September 2017, for instance, Italian Prosciutto di Parma applied and obtained a Japanese GI protection. It was quite easy because it was recognized already under EU GI. And then they applied for the Japanese GIs. So other foreign products are also encouraged to apply for Japanese GIs. So next slide, we moved to the topic of Japanese custom clearances, process procedures at the Japan customs. As you see on the diagram, before you make a shipment to Japan, EU exporters need to choose the importers and the distributors, and then you get the permit, and then you prepare the commercial documents for your partners. And EU exporters obtain its export permit and a prepare commercial document, which will be the information source for the Japanese importers to perform custom clearances. So it's very important. It's very important to provide accurate information, detailed information to your Japanese importers in order to speed up the custom clearance processes. Based on a commercial document prepared by the EU exporters, Japanese importers lodge an import declaration. This import declaration can be done 7 days prior to the arrival of the cargoes. When a cargo arrives at the Japanese port or airport, a custom office notified as the exporter designated importers and a custom clearance starts. Your product then go through a legal and then regulatory clearances in light of the relevant laws and regulations. Clearances are done mostly digitally, so while there can be a physical spot check for risk assessment. When legal and regulatory clearances are done, importers apply for the preferential tariff rates for EU products, and the importers, Japanese importers, has to pay duties, custom duties, excise taxes. Excise taxes are internal taxes, and then consumption tax. Some imported products like meat products may need a proper labeling before leaving custom to Japan. But most of the products like processed products, wines, they need a labeling after leaving customs. Can we go to the next slide, please? So I show you the legal regulatory clearances for more details. The first part on your left, the fresh and frozen vegetables, fruits, seeds, grains, and beans go through two quarantine clearances. One is a plant quarantines, and second one is sanitary and phytosanitary quarantines. We move on to the middle. It's a meat and a meat products. They go through two quarantine clearances. The first one is animal quarantine, and the second one is a sanitary and phytosanitary clearances. The last one, dairy products, liquors, fishery products, other processed food and drinks, and food additives, they only go through only one quarantines, which is a sanitary and phytosanitary quarantines. As I said, these are on the digital clearances, so that at home, you prepare clearance papers, and it goes automatically. Japan Customs recognize a number of EU laboratory and the governmental agencies, including Bulgarian laboratories and the agencies, and they accept their certificates, which replace the physical inspections, provided that the Bulgarian exporters obtain and supply such certificate to Japanese importers in advance. Please note that the Japan custom conduct random testing for risk assessment. There are other simplified ways for EU products to enter Japanese market. Details will be discussed at the webinars we have done it in September, but there are other seminars organized by the EU Japan Center. So if you could take a look at the schedule to benefit from these webinars. Can we go to the next slide, please? So I'd like to talk about the good occasions to promote your products, good occasions to meet the potential Japanese partners. There are trade shows. Japan hosts a number of trade shows throughout the years. For food products, you may like to book and attend supermarket shows, which runs every February. Held every March. And in addition, there are many individual focus shows by sector or by subsectors. These schedules, show schedule is available on the JETRO site, which I gave it to you on the screen. Because of the corona restrictions, supermarket shows and the food ex has been canceled, and then they must be happening 2021, hopefully. But in addition, I'd like to mention about this, instead of you going to Japan, Japanese buyers are coming to Bulgaria as well. So you might meet buyers in Bulgaria, often it's in Sofia. Can we go to the next slide, please? So these are the sort of five major food fairs in Sofia. It's popular for Japanese buyers. Inter Food and Drink, Salon du Vin, Meat Mania, The World of Milk, Bulpec, International Exhibition for Bakery and Confectionery. I would like you to note that this, I'm going to talk about in detail the business cultures later, but there should be a due diligence when you select the Japanese partners. Norms in Japan is to have introductions to meet potential Japanese partners by third party, such as you could ask your embassies or you could ask your business, the trade association in Tokyo. And I would suggest that you choose the Japanese partners who are specialized in imported food and drinks. There are companies which are specialized in the Bulgarian food products. And you have to evaluate the Japanese partners' operational and financial capability and performances. Can we go to the next slide, please? Yes, we discussed. Can we go to the next one, please? So this is the end of my presentation, the first presentation. I'd like to proceed to question and answer sessions. And then I have a questions. I also put this link here, office@EU-Japan-EU. If you could mention that there's an expert support webinar on Bulgarian food exports to Japan and mention my name, and then I will answer to your any specific question you may have on your product or in your export cases. Thank you very much. I would like to invite your questions.
Ms. Nakabayashi?
Yes.
Thank you very much for your insightful presentation, as always. And indeed, we can now move to the Q&A session. You should be able to see the chat box. So if participants have any questions that they would like to ask our expert today, do not hesitate to type them in. We'll give at least a couple of minutes. Thank you very much.
For those of the participants that joined later due to the technical problems, we at the Bulgarian Industrial Association are making a recording of the webinar, and we will send it to you so that you could watch again, and then you can pose the questions to us and also to AU Japan, so that we could be useful to you.
Thank you very much, Christina. I don't see any other questions right now. So I guess we can now move to the second presentation today. And our second expert is Mr. Ivan Van Esbeek, who will present potential benefits in the food sector of the EU-Japan Economic Partnership Agreement. Ivan worked for more than 25 years at the European Commission, mainly in departments dealing with international trade negotiations in the field of agriculture. He is currently working as a freelance expert at the EU-Japan Center for Industrial Cooperation. Ivan, if you can hear us, do not hesitate and go ahead. And as well, similarly to Mr. Kabayashi's case, I will try to move the PowerPoint presentation slides for you.
Thank you very much. Eva, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you perfectly well.
Perfect. Good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure to be with you this morning and to give you a brief overview of the opportunities that are contained in the EU-Japan EPA for European and Bulgarian agri-food exports to Japan. Next slide, please. The EPA is an agreement that has been negotiated between the EU and Japan. It was signed in July 2018, and it entered into force on the 1st of February 2019. One can say that it's one of the most successful agreements ever concluded in agriculture between the EU and a third country. The EU has already concluded many free trade agreements and partnership agreements with third countries, but this one, it has been a very difficult negotiation, but the outcome is very favorable for EU agricultural and agri-food exports to Japan. One has to know that about 87% of EU agricultural exports to Japan will enter duty-free over time into that country. And there is not only a very favorable approach as far as market access is concerned, but one should also know that the agreement contains a high-level protection for European geographical indications, GIs. We will come to that later in this presentation. Next slide, please. Before continuing, it is worth underlining that small and medium enterprises represent about 88% of EU companies exporting to Japan. And these companies represent about 30% of the total value of these exports. These are overall figures, all sectors, industrial, agriculture, and so on. One should know that as far as agriculture is concerned, these figures are even higher than the 88% and the 30% in value. Just to underline the importance of SMEs in our bilateral trade with Japan. Next slide, please. Coming back to the EPA, just now a brief overview of the different types of concessions that are contained in the agreement. You have, first of all, the products and the tariff lines for which the duties have been eliminated at the entering into force of the agreement. So an immediate liberalization. So that means that these products today have already free access to Japan. In the schedule of the concessions contained in the agreement, these products are labeled with the code A. Now, I have to underline something very special. I say that these products are labeled with the code A. Most of these products are not contained in the schedule. I don't know the reason for that, but if you are looking for a concession in the schedule for a specific tariff line, a specific product, and you don't find anything, that is good news, because that means that the tariffs have been liberalized at the entering into force of the agreement, or that the tariffs were already zero in Japan for all WTO members before even the agreement entered into force. But the result is the same. If you don't find a tariff line in the schedule, that means that the duty is zero. A few are labeled, and then they are labeled with the code A, but most of them are not labeled. Important to know. I will later in this presentation indicate the websites where you can find all the tariff lines, also those which have been liberalized. But in the agreement, the situation is as explained. Then you have a second category of concessions. These are duty eliminations spread over a period, labeled with the code B. So that means at the entering into force of the agreement, there has been a first reduction of the tariff, and then spread over a number of years, the tariff will further decrease year by year to zero. And that period can be 5 years, 10 years, or so on. A third category of concessions are duty reductions spread over time. It's the same as the previous one, but the duty will never go to zero. It will go to a lowest level after a number of years and remain at that level. Then a fourth category are tariff lines for which there are concessions contained in the agreement, but within a quantitative limit. That means as long as exports over a given years in volume do not exceed a prefixed quantity for that product, then the concession applies. That can be zero duty, and that can be a duty reduction. So if the tariff quota is, for instance, 10,000, as long as the exports do not exceed 10,000 tons in a given year, the concession applies. As soon as the volume exceeds the tariff rate quota level, then the base rate, the WTO tariff, the MFN tariff, applies until the end of the year for the rest of the year. As soon as we come to a new year, then the quota opens again and the concession applies again. That is the system. For a very limited number of products, there are no concessions. And these products are excluded from any concession. The main product in that is rice. There are no mutual concessions for that product in the EPA agreement. Next slide, please. Before entering into a little bit more details, a few highlights of what the EPA is containing as concessions for the most important product groups. A first one is beef, where we have important tariff reduction to 9% spread over overall a period of 15 years. There is a safeguard that is in force, but the levels are rather high and above traditional trade flows. So there is no immediate danger that the safeguard will apply when these trigger levels would be reached. Second important sector is the pig meat. There we almost have free trade and there is a temporary safeguard as well. For wine, it's all good news because there we have a free trade since the entering into force of the EPA. For the hard cheeses, there also we have free trade spread over years or within a quota. I will explain the details later on. For the other cheeses, there is zero duty within the tariff rate quota. And for the processed agricultural products, very complex group of products as far as concessions are concerned. But overall, we can state that there is for a group, for a number of products, free trade as from the entering into force of the agreement or within a maximum period of 10 years and some within a tariff rate quota as well. More details later on. Next slide, please. So we come to the pig meat. It is a very important agricultural export product for the EU to Japan. We are now above already 1.2 billion euros and it represents more than 30% of the import market share. As far as fresh meat, chilled and frozen is concerned, we almost have a tariff elimination. For the sausages and the pork preparations, there is a full tariff elimination spread over a period of 5 years. And there is a temporary safeguard measure. Again, if a certain level of volume is exceeded, then the there will be a snapback duty, but it is at a very reasonable level. The good news is that the previous MFN safeguards, which regularly applied on EU exports to Japan, is no longer applicable. The only safeguard that can apply is the safeguard contained in the EPA. As far, I would like to come back to the tariff concessions. When you export pig meat to Japan, the thing you have to be aware of is there is a minimum price in Japan, the so-called gate price. And the concessions are in function of whether you export above the gate price or below the gate price. If you export below the gate price, and bearing in mind that two tariffs apply in Japan, you have an ad valorem tariff and you have a specific duty. When you export below the gate price, then the specific duties will be gradually reduced, not eliminated. And the ad valorem duties will be phased out for the carcasses and the half carcasses. And almost identical concessions apply for hams and shoulders. Now, when you export above the gate price, then the duties will be reduced to zero in 9 equal installments. So that means as long as you export above the gate price, the products shall enter in Japan duty-free as from the 1st of April 2027. And for the processed meat, there are almost identical concessions for high-priced and low-priced products. Next slide, please. Now we come to beef, and there we have an important tariff reduction from almost 40% ad valorem MFN rate to 9% in 15 years. When we talk just in the margin, when we talk about years, one has to know that in Japan, a fiscal year goes from the 1st of April to in 1 year to the 31st of March in the next year. I told in the very beginning of my presentation that the agreement entered into force on the 1st of February 2019. It has been agreed that the first year was the very short period between the 1st of February 2019 and the 31st of March 2019. The second year started on the 1st of April 2019 and went to the 31st of March 2020. The third year started on the 1st of April of this year. So that means today we are already in the third year. It's important to know that when you see the phasing out of tariffs in 15 years or in 10 years or in 5 years, bear in mind that today we are already in the third year. So as already said, there is a safeguard trigger, but the volume is very reasonable and it might disappear even on the long run. You find the details in the schedule of the tariff eliminations and tariff concessions contained in the EPA. I will give you the website at the end of this presentation. It goes without saying that this important tariff concessions for beef products is very welcomed after the long-lasting BSC ban, which has been in force for several years in Japan for EU beef products. But we should bear in mind that even today, 91% of beef imports in Japan are shared between the US and Australia. So we still have a long way to go to come at the same level as for Australian and US beef in Japan, but that important concessions will certainly be very helpful. Next slide, please. As far as dairy products and cheeses is concerned, the cheeses are, of course, also a very important key product with an average export volume in the years 2014-2016 of about 320 million euro for all cheeses per year. And the agreement offers zero duties for hard cheeses. The duties will be phased out over a period of 15 years. And next slide, please. There is a TRQ, a duty-free TRQ, contained within quantitative limits of, it was 20,000 tons in the beginning of the 2019, and the volume will grow up to 31,000 tons in 2031. So within that quantitative limit, there is a zero duty applicable if you export fresh and soft cheeses and processed cheeses to Japan. Exceptionally, this tariff quota might know a continued growth based on average cheese consumption growth in Japan. If the cheese consumption is growing in Japan, the tariff rate quota will grow with that consumption growth rate. This is very exceptional. and our cheeses can take advantage of them in the long run. Next slide, please. When briefly on other dairy products, important concessions can be noted in DPA for whey products in function of the mineral and the protein content. Most of the tariffs will be phased out, some within tariff rate quotas. And for a few products, a few whey products, the tariffs will only be reduced. Then a TRQ will provide preferential access for butter, skim milk powder, and buttermilk powder and condensed milk products. And finally, for lactose products, there is duty elimination, and for ice cream products, important duty reduction. Next slide, please. Then we come to wines. I know it's also important for Bulgaria, given your high potential of wine exports to third countries, including Japan. The EU is a main wine supplier to Japan with a trade value of more than 800 million or 13% of the EU total agricultural exports to Japan. For the EU wine industry, the agreement, just to give you an idea, the agreement will represent a duty saving of around 145 million euros per year. The concessions obtained in the EPA are very favorable because all the duties have been eliminated as from the 1st of February 2019. And I speak about duties for still wines and sparkling wines. And a very important issue is also a facilitation for EU oenological practice, which sometimes oenological practice can be an obstacle for exporting wines to third countries. If certain practices used in the EU are not recognized by the importing country, that can be a serious barrier. In this case, the EPA is foreseeing in a very important facilitation in that field. And then last but not least, the EPA also contains an important protection for EU GIs for more than 100 EU wine names. We will enter in more details as regards GIs further on. Next slide, please. For spirits and beers, there was already an MFN duty-free access for beers in Japan and for most of the spirits. And the remaining duties for spirits, which were not eliminated at MFN level, have been eliminated because of the EPA since the 1st of February 2019. So in a nutshell, everything is free today. All the spirits, all the beers can be exported duty-free to Japan. And there also an important GI protection for 28 spirits and 6 EU beers. Next slide, please. Then we come to the very wide and sometimes complex sector of processed agricultural products. It is clear that in this short presentation, I cannot enter into all the details of these products. I can just highlight a few. First of all, there is a group of products for which the duties will be eliminated over time, and the maximum period is 10 years. And we talk about pasta products, pastries, waffles, breakfast cereals, biscuits, chocolates, and so on and so on. So for all these products, be patient, the duties will be eliminated within a period of maximum. Some of them have a shorter period, but the maximum period is 10 years. Next slide, please. Then for another group of products, we have a better news, because for all these products there, the duties have been eliminated since the entering into force, since the 1st of February last year. And you see a few of them labeled in this slide. There are for wheat-related food preparations and barley, wheat and flours and so on, there are sizable TRQs with all sorts of concessions. For some of them, it's a duty reduction. For others, within the TRQ, it's a duty elimination. Next slide, please. Then I have been informed about specific Bulgarian products in the processed agricultural field. I tried to summarize them. First of all, jams, jellies, and marmalades. I know that Bulgarian rose jam has a high export potential. To my knowledge, there is no specific tariff line for that product in the Japanese customs tariff. So to my knowledge, these products, the Bulgarian rose jam, are classified under other jams. And there are two types of other jams, those containing added sugar and those not containing added sugar. You see the tariff lines there on the slide. These two tariff lines, the good news is that for both tariff lines, the duties have been eliminated since the entering into force of the agreement. So according to my analysis, Bulgarian rose jam can enter duty-free into Japan, whether it contains sugar or not. Then for other jams, with zero duties, we have jams of citrus fruit, other than containing added sugar, and other fruit jelly, other than containing added sugar. And for the remaining jams, jellies, and marmalades, mainly containing added sugar there we have tariff liberalization between periods going from 3 to 10 years. Next slide, please. Then as regards spices, there we have a duty-free access for all the tariff lines, with the exception of curry. For that product, we have a gradual duty elimination spread over 5 years, so that as from the 1st of April 2023, the product can enter duty-free in Japan. And then for the vegetable saps and extracts, there also, for a large majority of the products, there is a duty-free access, except for products basis for beverage, other than opium, of licorice, of hops, and ephedra. Products obtained from a single material of vegetable origin, there we have a gradual duty elimination over 5 years, and for the others, there is a gradual duty elimination spread over 7 years. Next slide, please. So that brings me to the end of the market access issue. A few more words on geographical indications. First of all, I have to highlight that in the agreement, there are no Bulgarian GIs in the field of agriculture protected in the EPA. The only two Bulgarian GIs that are protected are in the wine sector. And they have already been mentioned in the previous presentation. You have the Trakishka Nizina and the Dunavska Ravnia wines. These wine names are protected in the agreement. Now, what does that mean? That means that there is a direct protection under the EPA. That means that there is the automatic administrative enforcement under the agreement for that protection. So that means, in concrete words, if you have that GI, you don't have to undertake steps. It is done via a direct administrative enforcement through the agreement. So Japan has the legal obligation through the agreement to protect all the wine names and all the other GI names that are listed in the relevant annex contained in the EPA. That means also that there is a GI protection in relation with trademarks. There will be no registration in Japan of subsequent trademarks bearing the same name as a GI listed and protected under the EPA. And there might be, there is some coexistence between GIs, between some GIs listed in the agreement and pre-existing trademarks in Japan. That is addressed. And as regards prior uses of GIs, these are about to expire within 5 or 7 years. 5 years for GIs related to wines and spirits, and 7 years for GIs related to foodstuffs. And what is important to know is that there is the possibility to add new GIs in the future, bearing in mind that there are at the moment, no Bulgarian foodstuff GIs listed in the agreement, but the door remains open for those who are interested that a GI should be added to the list. That is possible. The channels to do so are foreseen in the agreement. I can only underline, as an ex-official of the European Commission, I can underline the importance, the marketing importance of a product bearing a protected GI name in the export of that product. Your product will be exported much more easily with a GI name than a product who bears no GI name. There are statistics proving that. So you have all the interest that if your product fulfills the conditions to obtain a GI, get a GI, and try, once you have it, try to list it in the EPA so that it remains automatically protected in Japan. I can only underline that importance. Next slide, please. A last topic, and not the easiest one, are the rules of origin. It's also a very complex area, and I will try to explain in a couple of slides what it contains, but it is extremely important. If one wants to obtain a concession for a product in Japan, if you want to benefit from an EPA preference, a product must be originating in the EU or Japan. Now, the interpretation of originating should be carefully analyzed. To be originating, the product must comply with two main issues in the agreement. And they should be read very carefully before you export your product to Japan. First of all, What should be read and respected are the provisions, rules of origin of the EPA text, chapter 3. I will not go here into details, but I will later explain the website where you can find it, but it should be carefully analyzed what it means to be wholly obtained and all the conditions that must be fulfilled in order to be originating, that in order that the product concerned is originating. And a second criteria that has to be respected, or a group of criteria, are the product specific rules, the PSRs, for each product or each product group, annexes 3A, 3B of the agreement. There you find further requirements in order to be originating. And these requirements can include, for instance, a change in tariff classification or a production process or a maximum value of non-originating materials used in that production of that product or a minimum regional value content of these materials. I will try to explain all this via a few examples in the next slide. Next slide, please. So for instance, one of the easiest cases, for instance, is chapter 8, edible fruit. If you want to export edible fruit to Japan, the product must be wholly obtained. That means that the product must be entirely produced from A to Z in the EU. It must be grown and harvested, as far as fruit is concerned, in the EU. That's the easiest case. Where it becomes a little bit more complicated is, for instance, for 2001 products, prepared fruit and vegetables, where the PSR is change of chapter, CC. That means that in the preparation of the product, non-EU Japan originating materials may be used in the production of that good if these materials are classified under another chapter. So if a material is used in the production of that product and the classification of that material is, for instance, chapter 17, other than chapter 20, then it can be imported from outside the EU and Japan and used in the production process of the chapter 20 product. Where it becomes a little bit more complicated even is in the next example, heading 1806, chocolate and other chocolate cocoa preparations, where you have CTH. First of all, CTH is similar to CC. It's change of tariff heading. It's similar to change of chapter. It is more or less the same. So that means that non-EU Japan originating materials may be used in the production of the goods if these materials are classified in another heading, not in another chapter as above, but in another heading. And in this case, and two more conditions are satisfied. First of all, the total weight of the non-originating materials, if classified in chapter 4, dairy, and of heading 1901, used, does not exceed 10% of the weight of the product. And that the total weight of the non-originating materials of heading 1701 sugar and 1702 other sugars does not exceed 30% of the weight of the product. So this is an example where you have a variety of conditions under the PSR in order that a product should comply with the requirement to be originating. If you fulfill these conditions, then your product can be exported to Japan and take advantage of the concession. If you do not fulfill these concessions, these conditions, then you can also always export to Japan, but you will not have the concession. And you will pay the normal base rate MFN duty on importing your product in Japan. Next slide, please. So what's left are information sources. The most important one, of course, is where to find the agreement. You find it on that website of the European Commission, and in which you will find in Annex 2A all the schedules and the notes. The notes are also very important. You find the explanations on the different concessions, the explanations on the different TRQs, for instance. In Annex 2A, you also find all the explanations in wine facilitating issues if you want to export wine to Japan. Annex 3B, extremely important. You find, just as just explained, the product specific rules of origin. And in Annex 14B, you will find all the explanations as regards geographical indications. Next slide. The overall import conditions have been already explained in detail in the previous presentation, but you find also explanations in a market access database published by the European Commission DigiTrade, where you find not only the import conditions, but also all the tariff lines and all the concessions, including, and I refer what I said into in the beginning, including the tariff lines, which have been liberalized already at the entering into force of the agreement. There, in that database, you will find all the tariff lines, including the zero duty ones. Import conditions also explained in the Food and Beverage Handbook published by DG Agriculture of the European Commission. And you find also useful information and also all the tariff lines, including the zero duty ones, on the website of Japan's Customs Services. Next slide, please. Overall explanations, if you want to learn more about the complex issues of rules of origin, you find, you see here three useful websites published by DG TechSuite of the European Commission, and useful information also on the rules of, on the geographical indications, sorry, also published by the European Commission. And then next slide, last but not least, it has already been explained by Eva at the beginning. Also, useful information can be found on the website of the EU Japan Center. Many webinars have already been held in detail on sector by sector. In the past, they are published on the website, as well as fact sheets that have been drafted also in parallel with these webinars on the issues contained in the EPA sector by sector. I thank you very much for your attention. And if you have further questions, I will try to reply them now or in writing later on. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ivan, for this thorough presentation. And now, again, we'll give a couple of minutes for any further inquiries. Thank you very much.
Just a quick interaction. The Bulgarian Industrial Association will be planning at the beginning of next year a specific webinar dedicated exactly on a very on a useful tool for access to markets that is already available, in which the companies could check their and make a self-assessment, especially on the rules of origin, as far as their export is concerned to different countries, including Japan. So we would be organizing this and we'll issue to many participants an invitation on how they could use it alone and how can they make self-assessments for the different products they have. Shall we continue?
Yes, indeed. I don't see any questions. So I guess we can move to the last bits of our session today. And Ms. Nakabayashi, can you hear me well?
Yes. And you? Can you hear me?
Yes, perfectly. Thank you very much. Go ahead.
Okay. So welcome back. Now I'm presenting a second part of my presentation. I'm going to talk about the Japanese culture and business practices. Can we go to the next slide, please? So I have the following agenda. The first one is we are going to talk about Japanese business culture. Second, business practices. Third, modes of export to Japan. Fourth, Japan's distribution system. And then I will conclude with a question and answer sessions as before. So let's begin with the first one. Can we go to the next slide, please? So I have given you a map. So Bulgaria and Japan are 8,931 kilometers apart on the map. There are some similarities and differences in culture, business cultures between the two countries. So I should be mentioning some examples. For instance, that the both culture, the Japanese culture and then Bulgarian culture, both dislike uncertainty. So both similarly use a set of rules, regulations, and try to attempt to avoid uncertainties. On the other hand, there are differences between the two cultures. For instance, like a competition drives Japanese group-based society, while quality of working lives is a driving force in Bulgaria's collective society. So I'm going to show you a slide. By doing so, I introduce five major distinctive Japanese cultures, which you would likely face when dealing with Japanese partners. Or if you are exporting already, you might have already faced these distinctive cultures. Understanding these five basic cultures, you'll be able to avoid predicted misunderstanding and succeed business partnership with Japanese counterparts. Okay, let's start with the first one. The first one is a consensus-based decision-making. Japanese decision-making process is very slow. This is because all the decisions must be agreed by each layer of hierarchy up to the top management. It goes from bottom up. In Japanese society, power is equally distributed. And decision-making is consensus-based. So as you see on the top of the slide, there's a photo. all employees in a company in the line of hierarchy must agree and sign off company decisions in writing. So the second one, loyalty in group. Japanese in group act quite differently from situation to situation. Japan is a group society and Japanese are very loyal to the groups that they belongs to. So that the Japanese in group act at one unit according to various situations. Groups can be a company, groups can be a sports club, groups could be a school or any kind of entities. And Japanese belongs to multiple social groups. When Japanese are alone, however, they are quite individually private, reserved, than most other agents. Can we go to next one? Number three. Group-based competition. Japanese dislike assertive competitive individual behaviors. However, Japanese in-group engage in quite intense competition between groups. In business, Japanese employees are most motivated when they compete with other companies. You see in Japan that the group competition drives Japanese in-group to manufacture excellent, perfect product and services in order to own the market reputation for their companies. Number four, avoiding uncertainty. In Japan, life is highly ritualized and changes are quite difficult to make. Ceremonies like a wedding, school opening, even a company events are well manualized and the people don't like to go against precedents. In business, a lot of time and efforts are put into feasibility studies and all the risk factors must be eliminated before any project can start. Managers ask for all the detailed facts and figures before taking any decisions. That's why you receive many requests from Japanese counterparts, partners, to provide them with the detailed information of your products, services, before making any business decisions, dealings. Japanese attempt to avoid uncertainty or they try to avoid a surprise by preparing all what they can do to avoid uncertainties. Number five, the last one, long-term commitments. Japan is a long-term oriented society. Life is seen as a short moment in the history of mankind. Lives are guided by the virtues and the practical good examples. In business, companies focus on a business continuity and make a long-term investment in business. As for business goals, many companies, Japanese companies, focus on long-term commitments to society as a whole. Japanese companies once decide to keep a long-term business relationship with you, then they would make a long-term commitment to your company as a long-lasting business partners. So in conclusion, you need a bit of patience to build a long-term relationship with a Japanese counterpart. Next slide, please. So now we will see how these business cultures, I talked about the 5 points, these points reflect on the Japanese business practices. I will give you 8 points. The first point, formality and ritualism. Japanese business is formal and ritualistic, particularly when meeting business partners for the first time. To meet Japanese business partners for the first time, you may ask a third party to introduce you to Japanese potential partners. On your behalf, this third party will explain about your company, your position, your subject that you will like to discuss. This way, Japanese business person will be more favorably available than if you just walk in without any introductions. Second point, two-tier business relationship. To establish a long-lasting business relationship in Japan, you need to set up a two-tier business relationship structure. First, establish friendship, and then move on to the second stage of actual business negotiations. Once you made this initial introduction, occasions to meet your Japanese partners outside of business would be a good opportunity to get to know them personally. Next slide, please. Third point, name card. Name card is called meishi in Japanese. Name cards are exchanged on every occasion when one business person meets another. The prime purpose of exchanging name card is to make business positions and status known to others. Business cards also help to know instantaneously the names and the positions of business counterparts. And you can record for future reference so that you would avoid an embarrassing situation that you don't recall the name of business partners. Fourth point, business correspondence. There may be a situation where you write business inquiries to Japanese counterpart, but there's no reply at all from them. This does not necessarily mean that there's a Japanese counterparts lack interest in you in your business, but it is often due to the slow decision-making process, or Japanese companies are accustomed to talk face-to-face so that they may be waiting for the next occasions to answer to your inquiries. Another reason for failing to reply to you could be there's nobody who writes English, who speaks English at this moment. So my advice is, yeah, don't hesitate to call them and then talk to them on the phone or on online and ask their replies. Next slide, please. So fifth point, dress code. Dress code is a communication form in Japan. Japanese business people choose a dark suit for men and a sober plain dress for women. Most Japanese people are quite familiar with foreigners, so they expect a certain variety of dress code among foreign business people. However, I would really suggest that one should avoid extremes in dressing, and one should respect some degree of formalities in dressing in Japan. Sixth point, yes and no. The Japanese term hi is yes, but this yes can mean yes, I see, or yes, I understand. So it doesn't really mean that necessarily means that they agree to you. Japanese culture emphasizes harmonies rather than confrontation. So Japanese are very reluctant to give a direct answer no. Instead of answer no, Japanese answer with something non-committal, such as let me think. You must therefore learn to read the negative response signs, such as hesitancy or unwillingness, to be more specific. Next slide, please. Seventh point, silence in negotiations. Long period of total silence are quite common in Japan. This is because Japanese like time to think over what has been said and what alternatives are open to them. Silence is also a part of Japanese communication procedure. Bulgarians may find the silence is embarrassing and feel obliged to say something unnecessary just to relieve the tension. But the best way to handle such silence with Japanese is to exercise restraint, patience. Just wait until they say something after the silence. Last point, long-term commitment and due diligence. Japanese take long-term approach to prepare for future uncertainty. on business dealing, some Japanese companies, particularly small companies, they may prefer to make a broad agreement or so-called mutual understanding, rather than making contract terms and conditions, because they desire to allow both sides to adjust to unforeseen circumstances. However, due diligence should be paid to, particularly payment terms and conditions. You have to be clear on the payment terms and conditions in order to avoid business troubles at the later stage. Legal settlement of dispute are quite rare in Japan. So it's advisable to agree in writing before committing to business deals. However, when you deal with a large company, large Japanese companies, a legal contract is always agreed and signed. Next slide, please. So we move to the topic of modes of export to Japan. Establishing a direct business presence in Japan from the start is quite expensive and risky, particularly for small businesses. Bulgarian exporters may consider choosing a suitable mode of export to Japan by taking into account of your operation and financial capabilities. There are less expensive modes of export available to small size companies, such as simply making sales by shipping to Japanese buyers on based on the international contract, or by contracting a Japanese agent to sell your product in Japan, or franchising, licensing, and various ways. So now I'm going to explain to you these options one by one. The first one is sales based on the international contract. So this is the simple, inexpensive, and less risky options. This includes the usual FOB, free on board, CIF, exporter pays the cost, insurance, and freight, and many other conditions. Under these such international contract of sales, Bulgarian exporters take all payments and risks on cost and freight insurance only up to your chosen destination, such as at the port of exporters' countries or port of importers' country, depending on how much risks and then cost that you are able to take. The second option is the use of Japanese agent. So there are different types of agent in Japan. That could be an importer, that could be a distributor, that could be a representative, it could be retailers. So this secondary inexpensive way to sell export product to Japan, there are certain difficulty for you in terms of the selection, how to select your Japanese agent and how to manage your agent. So my advice is that the Bulgarian exporter should choose the agent who are specializing in imported goods and who are so-called multitaskers. Occasionally you find it's a very skillful agent who does import distribution. Even if they might have a retailing skills or capabilities. Pay attention to how many agents to hire. You could hire many one exporters, three distributors, multiple retailers. Then it's them you would hire so many agents, and then you have to pay a comprehensive due diligence to so many people. So you have to be very careful when you select your Japanese partners, and also you have to be careful on how many agents you are going to select in your business dealings. Next slide, please. Now you have a franchising, licensing, and joint ventures I listed here. These are alternative to exports. Agriculture franchising, which is becoming quite popular, and then also agriculture licensing is also popular. And joint venture, you could set up a new company with your Japanese business partners. So all of these has advantages and disadvantages. So I suggest that the US assess your operational and financial capabilities, and then you wisely choose export businesses. In terms of export, well, as long as you export your products and then ask Japanese distribution systems to sell, it is the importers who pay the custom duties. So in terms of the custom duties, you would use the level of custom duties as a sort of a strategic tools to negotiate with your agent or partners. So as a conclusion, it is a general principle that this Bulgarian exporters select the most suitable mode of export in view of your operational financial capabilities. In deciding the mode of export, however, Bulgarian exporters should pay particular attention to number one, Japanese business culture, as we discussed. Number two, Japanese multi-layer distribution system, which will be the next topic of our discussion. Next slide, please. So, Japanese distribution system. Traditional Japanese distribution system is described in the flowchart on the slide. It starts from producer, distributors, you could choose more than one, national wholesaler, regional wholesaler, local wholesaler, and retailers, and it goes to the customers. In modern distribution channels, there should be less and less intermediaries between producers and consumers. Next slide, please. So I'm going to talk about the characteristic of Japanese wholesaler distribution system. The core, the heart of Japanese distribution system is a wholesaler distribution system model, where that the wholesalers purchase products in large quantity and resell to retailers. This model works well in Japan because the rapid urbanization caused dense population in large cities like Tokyo and Osaka, and the small retail stores became major point of customer sales. Those small retailers in large cities have a limited storage space and also sales space. So the wholesalers deliver small amount of product more frequently to perform as a warehouse. Also, this matches with Japanese consumers' habit to purchase goods in smaller. Japanese consumers, they go to stores every day, particularly this food and drinks. They purchase every day, and maybe it's more than once a day. And they buy it in small quantities. And they demand freshness, safety, authenticity, variety in food products. Their demand is not daily or weekly. It's their demand goes to hourly freshness, hourly safety. It's very precise. Next slide, please. So taking advantage of Japanese distribution system. So why not a Bulgarian exporter using the Japanese distribution system? For the first time, Bulgarian exporter may see that the Japanese distribution system very redundant and inefficient. However, it becomes clear for you that the Japanese distributors take on many things, all logistic transactions, they take on promotion of goods, financial risks on the prepayment to producers and receivables from retailers. So Japanese distributors can be a good business solution for Bulgarian exporters to adapt the market needs and can be a cost-effective alternative to direct sale in Japan by setting up your own companies or setting up your representative at least. Next slide, please. So searching Japanese B2B or B2C partners. How do we do it? So when you search for Japanese partners, please do not be trapped in the Japanese distribution system, not so advantageous side of the system. If you hire excessive number of intermediaries, it would cost you. Too many intermediaries in your business would impose heavy operational and financial burden on you. So to avoid these problems, number one, you have to search Japanese partners who are specialized in imported products. Number two, such Japanese partners who have a good extensive business network in the relevant sector, in your sector or subsectors. Number three, search Japanese partners who deal with the targeted customers, your targeted customer, but not preferably not dealing with your direct competitors. Number four, search Japanese partners who have a good geographical coverage of interested area. For instance, Japanese Senmon Shosha, or it's a specialized trading company, fit into these profiles. So I provide some examples on the following slide. Can we go to the next slide, please? So this is a distribution outlet. I made it a map and I showed the regions. So geographically, you can see that Japan has a 7 regional markets. The map on the screen shows the size of these 7 markets in color, in different color, by comparing to the size of European economies. In the middle, you have this Kanto region. It's indicated in pink, where Tokyo is located. It's the largest market, which is equivalent to the size of the Italian economy. And this is followed by Chubu, the south of the Tokyo, and the Kansai regions where industrial hubs are concentrated. In Chubu, you have a Nagoya, and then in Kansai, you have Osaka, 2 large cities. The size of regional market is an indicator for you, for Bulgarian exporters to choose which importers, which distributors, which retailers to choose. Next slide, please. So this is a B2C retail outlets, convenience stores. So majority of consumers use convenience stores every day for quick purchase of daily food, which are found at every corner of Japanese cities. There are about 58,000 convenience stores in Japan. The map on the slide shows their geographical strengths of major 4 convenience stores: 7-Eleven, Lawson, Family Mart, and Seiko Mart. You notice that this Seiko Mart has the market share, exclusive market share on the Northern Island, but not other part. So when you target your customers, you may, this map may be the indication for you to choose your convenience stores. Next slide, please. So next one is a B2C. Another B2C outlet. So we have supermarket and department stores for a large quantity or variety of daily food purchases, much more than the convenience stores. So there are over 22,000 supermarkets and over 200 department stores. There are roughly 2 types. There are either price quality focused stores or discount stores. There are supermarkets specialized in imported food and drinks in large cities. Next slide. These are just an examples. I give you an example of specialized general stores for imported food to B2C. There are supermarkets, a specialized coffee shop, Japanese meat companies. Surprising to you that this Bulgarian products, I showed it to you previously, some packaged food. They are sold in all of these shops. Seijo Ishii carries the Bulgarian packaged food, Caldi Coffee as well. Even some meat shops sells the Bulgarian packaged food, so on. In the middle, you have a bio bone. That also carries a Bulgarian some natural products, packaged food. Can we go to next slide, please? This is also some example of specialized discount stores for imported food to B2C. Don Quixote is the largest. Next one is Daiso. This is an international store, but this is very common in Japan. And Carnival, Okane, and Kaneda, and so on. They all carry Bulgarian packaged food. Do we go to next slide, please? Last table is an example of specialized trading companies for B2B. Kobe Busan, Itochu, and then so on. Some of them, not all of them, but this carries the Bulgarian food at this moment. So in case if you're interested in B2B, you may like to contact them. Some are quite big, some are not. And then I indicated their specialties. Do we go to next slide, please? So we come to the end of the session. Thank you for your listening. And now we proceed to question and answers. As I mentioned before, if you prefer to send us questions or comments in writing, I indicated the contact email address on the slide. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Nakabayashi, for this very interesting presentation. And again, similarly to a previous session, if you have any further inquiries to our expert, Ms. Nakabayashi, today, do not hesitate to use the chat box. We'll give a couple of minutes if there are any inquiries. Otherwise, do not hesitate to send us an email to office@eujapan.eu. Thank you.
Thank you also from my side. That's a lot of information for the time that we spent. Thank you really very much to you, Eva, and to both experts for their patience and for reacting so swiftly to the technical problem that we had. So for our companies, if you really have a question, that's the time to ask. Don't be shy. Yeah, we have a question I would like to ask. Okay. I would like to ask about the requirements for export of probiotics to Japan. What certifications are needed? Okay.
I think Ms. Nakabayashi, are you still with us? I think this would more probably appeal to Ms. Nakabayashi.
Oh, I'm sorry. I turned it on.
Yeah, okay. No worries. Can you see the chat box?
Yes, I do. Yes.
Okay, perfect.
Can I suggest to Ms. Yotova Maria, would you please write your questions to office@eujapan.eu so that I could give you a link and then more details for the requirements for the certifications.
Yes.
Next question is about this, the list of importers for wine and liquors. There are some wine bars. If you want to know these wine bars, these sort of retailers, I could give you some, but this what I listed on the screen, these are the buyers. There are markets, supermarkets, department stores, trading companies. They do import wines and liquors. You could contact them. Actually, I listed Miren. I selected these examples who are already buying Bulgarian wines and liquors as well. As we got for the presentation, I'm sure you will receive a presentation by from the organizers.
Thank you very much, Ms. Nakabayashi. I don't see any other questions in the chat box. So I guess that concludes today's webinar. I would also like to thank our YEN partners, Bulgarian Industrial Association and Sofia, and especially Christina for her support and cooperation in organizing the session. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you as always to our experts, Ms. Nakabayashi and Mr. Venesbeck, for their excellent presentations and answering all inquiries. And thank you to all participants for turning up today, for your patience in waiting and contributing to today's session. I hope it was a constructive webinar for you all. And for any further information, do not hesitate to contact our partners or myself at ava@eu-japan.eu or just simply send your inquiries to office@eujapan.eu as you can see on the screen. You will also, just a short reminder, you will also receive all PowerPoint presentations that were used today and the recording of today's webinar shortly after today's session. Thank you very much again and have a great rest of the day.
Thank you, Eva.
Thank you, Christina.
Have a nice day and till the end month, festive month.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Likewise. And we'll talk soon.
Thank you, everybody. Stay healthy and have a nice day. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.